I really appreciate your attendance tonight. You're in for a treat. So tonight we are joined by artist Stephen Hannock and special guests, his dear friends and ours, the Simpson family. You'll soon learn how these wonderful folks are connected and about Stephen's connections to Cody and to Yellowstone. An explication of these ties lies within the incredible painting, Flooded Cascade, Yellowstone Dawn, which hangs prominently and proudly in our gallery. You all know it. You can't miss it when you're walking through the Whitney. It's composed of three panels. It measures 8 feet tall by 12 feet wide. It makes for a fabulous contemporary counterpoint to our treasure trove of historical American landscape paintings. What look like striations on the soaring cliff faces of the lower falls or brushstrokes elsewhere in the canyon are, in fact, hundreds of lines of text, plus layered, collaged materials like newspaper clippings and photographs. So what messages and meanings are hidden in plain sight? What do these stories tell us? What stories are the layers and layers of luminous, polished paint? What are they going to tell us? What do they hold? Is this a landscape or a portrait instead? Is it, in fact, a diary? We'll hear a bit more about these ideas from the artist himself. Who better? An artist who happens to be a leader in his field, a top landscape painter who has created a style that's immediately recognizable the world over. Stephen's work can be found in some of the most esteemed museums and private collections across the US and Europe and beyond. To name a few, the Met and that other Whitney in New York, the Smithsonian American Art Museum in DC, and the MFA Boston. And here, where our painting has been long on loan in an arrangement facilitated by Sue Simpson Gallagher, Michelle Sullivan, and former Whitney curator Mindy Besaw. We thank Stephen so much for joining us tonight. I'd like to extend a hearty thanks to the more than 90 donors who contributed to the Peter Hassrick Public Programs Fund, which perpetuates our friend Peter's efforts and passion about connecting people from around the world to stories of the American West through programs just like this. I'd also like to thank the Whitney's curatorial assistant, Dr. Ashley Espinall, for coordinating many, most, all of the details for tonight's program, alongside colleagues Josie Hederman, Rachel Johnson, Liz Holmes, and our facilities and IT teams. Finally, I will formally, well, symbolically at least, pass the baton to Susan Barnett, who is my successor as the Scarlet Curator of Western American Art for the Whitney Western Art Museum. Susan joined us last week, and we are thrilled that she's on board. The future of the Peter Hassrick Public Program series is in really good hands with Ashley and Susan, and I'm not going anywhere. I'm just settling into a new managerial role here at the center, and I'm really looking forward to helping support this initiative moving forward. Thank you, and with that, Susan.
Thank you so much, Karen, for that lovely welcome. It is such a great honor to continue the tradition of scholarship, stewardship, and storytelling that the Whitney's exceptional curators, such as Karen McWhorter and Mindy Besaw before her, have established. I am thrilled that the wisdom, expertise, and deep connections to Western art and to the people in this community that Karen brought to the Scarlet Curator position are still available to the Whitney and to me. I'm really excited to be back in the West, where I've lived for almost 3 decades, and which always feels like home. I look forward to researching the excellent collections of the Whitney, immersing myself in the cultural and outdoor life of Cody, and reconnecting with the living artists that live here in the Plains and Rocky Mountains. Thank you all for welcoming me here. So tonight's presentation highlights some of the unique opportunities the Whitney Western Art Museum offers for storytelling. This magnificent painting by Stephen Hannock, which I hope you've all had a chance to see. If not, please be sure to get into the gallery and take a look after the presentation. It's installed so that it's in conversation with some spectacular historic works of similar subjects by some of America's preeminent 19th and 20th century artists. Stephen likes to remind us that all art is contemporary. The historic art, as well as contemporary, was made by living, breathing artists. He very consciously pays homage to the painters that came before him while finding new ways to challenge and engage contemporary audiences. Considering that the Buffalo Bill Center's mission is to connect people with the stories of the American West, it's apt that Stephen's stories are very literally embedded in this painting. So I am just thrilled that Stephen decided graciously to donate this painting to the Whitney following its long-term loan. It is... Thank you so much, Stephen. It is a wonderful addition to our collection. So now, please enjoy a short video about Stephen and his work, and that will be followed by a presentation from Stephen and an opportunity for questions. Thanks all for being here.
I also think landscape painting is pretty rare in the modern era, but it still looks modern. It looks contemporary. It doesn't look like he's from the 19th century.
We were walking on Madison Avenue, and there was a gallery, and I looked in the window, and I fell in love with this painting. And Craig looked at me and said, you know, I think I went to school with that guy.
I knew him as a goalie for the hockey team, and he was, I think, in a band. I couldn't make the connection between the hockey player, drummer, and this amazing artist.
And here you have a hockey player who goes on to an all-girls school, who goes on to be an artist. This man is his own guy. And you look at his art, and instead of going to some cookie-cutter mold of how the modern artist should be, Stephen has gone his own way. And I was fascinated by an updated, modernistic approach to landscape painting that involved the luminosity that the original Hudson River School had employed.
My first time that I saw Stephen's painting was in 1989, when he was a starving artist in Soho, and he created these magnificent, big landscapes.
Well, the Met owns two paintings by Stephen. Stephen uses landscapes that were also captivated former landscape painters. I think enhances that layered tradition. I love the diaries on the paintings. The diaries on the paintings are what allows me to see the past.
The text goes down spontaneously, much the way brush strokes go down. So I don't remember what I've said.
You know, Stephen's a little absent-minded sometimes. And I think he just writes on, so he put my number on a...
Well...
Nude. No, not definitely.
But for some reason or other, the moods that I want to express are best achieved with these thin veils of paint. I wish I could do larger or more abstract events or constructions of some sort, but it always goes toward these images that have a horizon somewhere.
Well, he's the most engaging person you can possibly imagine. I mean, he could be selling life insurance and you would still find him kind of irresistible as a personality. A lot of enthusiasm for what he's doing. Kinetic energy. He just lands with his mind and his heart open in your life.
One of the fun things about being his friend is when he calls you up and says, hey, I have this idea. And, you know, just get to hear the beginning of it percolating.
Stephen really became kind of the artist in residence at our ranch in Montana.
We have at the ranch a small herd of horses. One night, he got up and saw Ghost, our big white horse, running right past his window. He sketched that mystical image of Ghost that he had in his mind, which I think is just transporting for me.
If I were to characterize Stephen in one word, I would say inspired.
Whimsical. Insatiable curiosity.
Imaginative.
Extraordinary artist.
Exuberant.
Zest for life.
One word for Stephen? Maverick.
He often appears on very short notice or unannounced at our dinner table. He's one of the few people that I actually welcome under those circumstances and don't resent.
We are honoring Stephen Hannock for his ability to bridge the wonderful landscape tradition of the 19th century to the utterly contemporary landscape tradition of the 21st century.
Thank you all for joining us this evening. Please join me in welcoming Stephen Hannock.
Thank you. Thank you, Susan. And welcome to the Cody Circus. I'm sure, I'm not going to need that. But what a treat to be here. And one of the things that Karen and Susan neglected to mention is that I couldn't be more thrilled than to donate this piece that it really does belong in this remarkable museum. But it is being donated in honor of Anne and Senator Alan Simpson. And so this is very cool. In fact, this is not just because they give me free dinners every time I show up, much as the Brokaws do, but clearly, as we witness in this day and age, these two have set the bar for true elegance and honesty, composure, and a legacy to be proud of. They've set it really high, but not so high that we can't reach it ourselves. So for that, my generation is incredibly grateful, and we'll do our best to carry on for sure. So thank you. Now this is going to be, this is really fun to be here for this thing. I really was quite pleased to be involved with the Olana Partnership with that thing. The irony is that I never had even heard of the Olana Partnership until none other than Sue Simpson turned me on to this back in the late 80s or early 90s, and I'd never heard of these guys. And I got more and more involved with them, and eventually I was the first artist to get the Frederick Church Award. And I'm going, you think you want to bring in more artists to this thing? I mean, it's part of the deal, Church was an artist himself, I have to confess that I'm a little bit punchy from this, getting this label of heir to the Hudson River School. It's not really where I'm going with this stuff, but I'm honored to have the late, recently great, late artist Wayne Thiebaud as a friend, dear friend and champion, and I was complaining to him about 30 years ago that, I'm not the Joe Hudson River guy. Come on, I do all this other stuff. And he looks at me and he goes, you little punk, just be glad they're calling you something. And talk about sage words. This is really something. But one of the reasons why this fuss has been made over the some of my work over the last few decades is that the move I've made with this genre has been moving away from painting a place to setting a stage. And with that in mind, rather than following in the Hudson River School or the 19th century American painter's footsteps, I get a lot of my cues from 19th century British filmmakers, specifically Alfred Hitchcock and David Lean, who would use extra long establishing shots before they bring you into their stories. And for those of you who aren't quite up on filmmaking, an establishing shot is the image you see of the place that the story or the movie is about to happen. And traditional Hollywood likes to show you this place for 2 seconds and then they move on. Well, Alfred Hitchcock and David Lean would lean on these vistas for some time. And let me give you a little spin around the block here. This is, here we go. Now this is a scene in the movie North by Northwest that a lot of you are familiar with. And what we're doing is Cary Grant's character is about to be dumped off in the middle of Indiana. This is a 30-second establishing shot. We are in the middle of nowhere. We're actually in Bakersfield, California. In the upper right is the town of Bakersfield that's been painted out, but we're not supposed to know this. And here this bus is coming down Route 47 in the middle of nowhere, drops Cary's character off, and then takes off. And all we see is this vast area. And not unlike David Lean, the way he sprinkled charcoal in some of these scenes in Lawrence of Arabia to draw our eyes to the character, so did Hitchcock spray the fields off to the left, as you see, just to give our eyes something to move on. Then watch how he brings us in to visit, to see Cary on a closer view. This is the medium shot. You still see the low horizon there. This guy's in the middle of nowhere going, what the hell am I doing here? And now here he is, entirely swallowed up by the landscape where the horizon was up on that level. This is how Alfred Hitchcock brought us into this mood to tell the rest of the story, of course. And you know, he's about to get bombed, dive bombed by these crop dusters and stuff, which is always fun. Well, what I've done with my work is use the vista, use the actual landscape vista as the initial stage set. And what happens while I'm painting this, inevitably I'm thinking of characters that come into my mind that rather than just appreciate them and talk about them otherwise, I literally write these things through the painting. And they're just sort of detonators to longer stories that happen. And tonight I'm gonna give you a couple more of these stories, which are, hey, it happened. So, you know, we gotta, you know, talk about this. So the first thing I'd like to show you is, this is a painting that Thomas Cole did in the mid 19th century called the Connecticut River Oxbow. And in fact, this is the bend in the Connecticut River right by Northampton, Massachusetts, where, you know, I was going to be a pro hockey player like my dad, and I sort of got sidetracked for one semester to Smith College, had nothing to do with the women, I promise. But while I was there, I got to know Leonard Baskin, who was one of the half dozen great artists in the world at that time, who asked me to work with him privately after school. And long story short, I never made it back to Bowdoin College in hockey, but really had some art adventures that all began here. And here Thomas Cole's little bend in the Connecticut River is considered by many to be one of the key fulcrums of that first generation of painters in America. And what we're doing is we're going to go in a little tight, and you'll see a self-portrait. This is a little portrait where Cole's sitting there with his easel looking out there, which is, that's all fine and dandy, but Cole never lived in the Northampton Amherst area, so this is not fair. So I had to reclaim this place. I'd been there for 17 years before I moved to New York, and so this is the composition I use. It's not the first painting I did. This is actually a painting that was recently acquired by the Yale Art Gallery, but I use the same template. And what you'll see is in the foreground cornfields are actually diaries. That's where I tell stories about different things that happened in different places in this. And the Metropolitan Museum's first piece has no collaged images. I hadn't gotten into that yet. It was just the writing. And actually, I was telling Sue about this one today because I noticed it while I was copying down some of the notations in the painting here. But I used to go in there, unlike some of my musician friends who are very recognizable. Nobody knows who the painter is. So I'd go in there with one of the curators. We'd hang out and listen to people come through. And one day we were there, and I had one of the Oxbow paintings and then a large piece of Catterskill Falls about 9 feet high. And these two women came in. They were walking around the room. And if they weren't twins, they were definitely sisters. And they were followed by a guy who was married to one of them. And he couldn't have cared less about being there. He's walking and he's going, you know, like, so this is art, huh? Okay. You know, he couldn't have been more bored. And these women were looking at different paintings, and he walked over to the Oxbow, and he's checking it out, and he's going, and he's walking on, and he goes, "Son of a bitch! Hey, Margaret, you got it. There's writing all over this goddamn thing. Wait, I didn't think you were allowed to do that, you know?" I mean, from the mouth of babes, you know, we've been conditioned to understand that there's certain things you do with this genre of painting, certain, but writing through a traditionally acceptable representational form is usually not one of the things you deal with. But this was working for me. I just really was excited about sharing some of these stories. And we zero in on the lower right is where we're going on this piece. And I want you to see in the lower right-hand corner, the river that comes closer to us is actually an image. This is one of Chuck Close's daguerreotypes. And my wife and I modeled for Chuck's Adam and Eve daguerreotype. And this is special because this is where I learned what my daughter's name was going to be. I've known Chuck for a while. He was on the UMass faculty for a number of years while I was working with Leonard Baskin in Northampton. And I knew he had a daughter named Georgia. And my wife and I had already agreed that my daughter's name was going to be Chloe. And I actually wrote it in this giant Oxbow piece that the Metropolitan Museum acquired, and it was actually hanging while we were modeling for this thing. And we're sitting there naked as jaybirds under they're dark images, but daguerreotypes have this incredibly bright light with strobes, so that we're sort of in this huge, bright, you know, explosion of light, we know it's coming out dark. And anyway, I'm talking to Chuck and I'm saying, "Well, how's your daughter Georgia going?" And he goes, "Oh my God, she's in med school. She's gonna be a doctor." And I went, "Wow, that's incredible." And my wife is going, "Georgia, that's what we're calling our daughter." And I'm "Great, great, but can you let me in on these things? You know, just, you know, I'm along for the ride here, you know." And to this day, my daughter's pseudonym, her ulterior ego, is there written in the painting. She loves taking people in to showing her the wrong name. So this is one of these things where the diary goes a little astray, but the stories are still there. And of course, I'm only going to give you one story from each of these pieces, because each piece could take us, you know, hours over a bunch of really cool beers. So, but now this is a painting of Newcastle, England. This is the hometown of my musician buddy Sting, who was born in this area, and he was coming of age at a time when all the shipyards and the coal mines were closed. So you have one of the wealthiest towns in the world for 300 years. Over a 10-year period, everything disappeared. I mean, we've had some horrible depressions in Detroit, but we saw nothing. There were a million people out of work in Northern England. And he was asked to sing at the ribbon cutting of the Sage Gateshead, which is the object you see right in the center of this piece right there. It's the Performing Arts Center that was won by the city of Newcastle. It was a lottery where Manchester, Liverpool, and Newcastle were competing for this giant grant. Newcastle won. Norman Foster built this amazing facility. It's like an outdoor park indoors. Newcastle has the world's worst weather. I mean, you think Cody's bad in the wintertime? There's sleet coming down horizontal, and that's in the springtime in Newcastle. And so this is all there, and he's going to be singing at the ribbon cutting. And so he calls up and he goes, "Listen, this could be really cool, but do you think there's a painting there?" And I went, "Geez, I have no idea. Let me think about it." And the first idea I came up with was a 90-foot painting of this vista, 90 by 30 feet, that at a given moment we would unfurl it down the side of the building. Well, Sir Norman was less than pleased to have a giant tarp flapping across the gleaming glass side of his building at the moment of the ribbon cutting. So anyway, that didn't go anywhere. But it seemed like a perfect opportunity for these vistas with text. So we built these things, and rather than represent the closed shipyards with these slag heaps, I painted these blue-green ghost villages that sort of loomed in the darkness. And the coal mines are now represented by these blue starbursts. And from there, each one, all these different stories for each of these are listed in there. And we're going for the center object right there, the center shipyard that is now closed. But when you actually get close, you'll see that it's actually a painting by J.M.W. Turner that was painted of the River Tyne, of this exact same spot 300 years earlier. And the ships were a little differently, but the composition of the painting is remarkably similar to the starburst that I was using to relate for these. So these are the neat little surprises that we hide in these things. Let's move on. There's a lot to say about this piece. I got a call one day from a guy you might know named Robert Redford. He dabbles in movies and stuff. And he seemed to think that he had this place called the Sundance Institute that was about to celebrate his 25th anniversary. And he was wondering if I'd be interested in painting a giant vista to celebrate this thing. And the thing that got me was, he goes, if you don't want to do it, I'm not going to ask another artist. And so I said, well, yeah, I'm a busy guy, you know. You know, Bob, let me think about this. Anyway, part of the deal was I had to hang out with him for 2 years and collect stories. And let me tell you, that guy has some serious stories. But this is Mount Tapenagos, which is right behind, it's sort of at the peak of Sundance Canyon, and it is spectacular. And this particular view is the only view they've ever had that has the peak, but then you see it spirals down to this cauldron that was cleared out by thousands of years of waterfalls crashing through. And there's so many things to show here, but what we're gonna go zero in on this cliff right ahead. And these are snips from movies that were nascent at the Sundance Institute that Glenn Close was in. And I have her here in The Big Chill with Kevin Kline. And right in back of Glenn is a shot of her just 2 weeks after I did the original drawing for this thing, and she looks almost identical, some 20 odd years separated. So I thought that was a really fun thing. And okay, now here we go. This is the fun stuff. This is one of the things I like to do is paint these known vistas that are almost cliched in American history, but you gotta make them a little different. And what I wanted to do, I was traveling around with Sue and Michelle Sullivan, and they took me to Artist Point, where a lot of people go, and a lot of people, Sue, the bus stops there, and it's pretty spectacular. Thomas Moran did a stunning piece from there, as did many others. But I wanted to get a different view. So Michelle hooked me up with one of the park rangers who took me around the other side to this cliff that I could get a view, a very different view, and nobody was allowed in this area for one park. I said, this is just what I'm looking for. And he showed me, this is where you park, this, because I was gonna go there at 4:45 in the morning, way before the sun was gonna come up. I wanted to get this early dawn light for the drawing. And coming, so this is what you do, you just come to that edge there. And I said, well, that's pretty, that goes, drops right off. He goes, yeah, but you might want to tie yourself in. I said, oh, I'll just wrap my leg around a tree or something. This will be cool. And so I went back, said goodbye to the ladies, and they got me a place to stay in one of those cabins at the park. And I got up at 4:30, headed right to the place, and of course, it's pitch black. It's dark. There are creatures climbing around. I mean, I got so lost. I went, oh, here we are, and then you come out this thing, and there's, you know, the trash compactor. You know, that's not gonna work out. And so finally, I made my way to this path, and some of the light is starting to come up, and I'm really behind my schedule there. So I find the area, I get out over the, hang out over the area, wrap my leg around this tree, and I start drawing. And I wasn't drawing for 15 minutes before, just the way a Hollywood producer would signal a Hollywood follow spot to hit different sections. It's like the sun started hitting these different areas along, you know, different cliffs. It like bang, bang, bang. And I'm just going, holy shit, this is amazing. And clearly this was the foundation for what became a series of three paintings that I wanted to do with this thing. Letting them percolate for a while, the first painting, and I don't have the dates for these, but this is currently hanging in the Smithsonian in Washington. I was thrilled, you know, Karen mentioned that this museum is somehow affiliated with the Smithsonian. That's pretty cool. I didn't know that, but I can't wait to tell a few people about that this thing actually has some anchor that they won't know about. And this is the second one I did, bringing in the storm clouds that I saw in a different place, but I wanted to have them in this particular piece. And then the third piece is the piece we have here. And what I want to show you right now, this is fun, because the fun thing about this particular piece is I had the daughters of the three families that were responsible for my coming to the Rocky Mountain Zone. I had these three daughters sign the back of the painting. And this would be Sue Simpson, Michelle Sullivan, and Andy Brokaw. And I don't know if they're even married at that time, but there were certainly no kids anywhere to be seen. And I thought that was really cool because, you know, the whole nature of the way we want to honor Mother Nature and preserve these places for the generations that follow. Well, with the piece that we have in the Whitney Gallery here, there is a shot of these three women who have been joined by other characters. You know, maybe it's in the water, who knows? But and the thing that's so much fun about this piece is that I wanted to celebrate these women and the families, in a heroic way. But Andy Brokaw couldn't leave Montana. She was up there with her family, and it's a ways from Bozeman to Cody. But I was coming down here the next day, so I had Andy pose at 10:30 in the morning, looking southeast. Got a shot of her. The next day, I came down, shot the ladies with all their kids on the fence at the Bobcat Ranch at 10:30 in the morning, facing the southeast. And we put them together Photoshop. And so it looks like they're all hanging out together. And as you'll see here, and that story is told in the cliffs right underneath there. You'll see Andy to the left in front of her folks' place up in the West Boulder Ranch. And then just to the right is the completed setup for that. And so that is the way that's set up. Now, what I'd like to do right now, which is really fun, I have to read a couple of the passages that are in there because I didn't remember writing any of these things. And it wouldn't surprise me if some of these cowpoke around here wouldn't have added their own treatments, but they are coming back. And one of the things, this isn't in Braille, unfortunately. So
do you need some glasses?
Yeah, I do. And I've got them right here. Here, this is going to be good. No, this is going to be worth it. This is fun. So this first one was the story I just told you. So, and then there's a passage, and this is a lower part right in here. It says, "This canyon is spectacular, but everybody sees it from the artist's point. I want to do something from the other side." And then right next to it is over here is the same piece that I showed you that my late wife and I modeled for Chuck's piece. And we modeled for Chuck's Adam and Eve piece just before Georgia was born. And Bridget died 5 years ago from October when I was writing this, but we were married 10 years ago to the day that I was writing that on the painting. So there are actually events that were remembered on the specific day that I'm doing the diary that I try to make these connections with. So the idea being that real life happens with all of these pictures, the pieces you see in all these great museums. When you're viewing these paintings, you're breathing in the ear of the artist. You may be 500 years separated from that, but this is the thing that paintings have to offer that no other art form in the culture has to present to you. So that's really cool. And then something I completely forgot about, in this section right up here is the front page of the New York Times when Tom Brokaw retired. When Tom retired from the news desk at NBC, it signaled the end of an era of network news anchors as the trusted conscience of the nation. And isn't that interesting, looking at it from the context of where TV news has gone today? And then this is a piece right off. Those of you with kids will appreciate this. This is a section right in here. And tomorrow is Easter. My 9-year-old daughter, Georgia, is beside herself. You can't underestimate the anticipation of a good sugar buzz, you know. And then this area, this is cool. We're getting to the end of this particular section. This is an area up here, and we start up there. That is actually the cross-section of a tumor I have in my left eye, and it's blinding me. It's not going to kill me, but it's one of these things we deal with, you know, and I just needed to learn about this thing, and it was pretty horrific. It was diagnosed as ocular melanoma that I'd had for over 6 years, which is a long time to have that. So I went home and made arrangements for my daughter's adoption, and we just lost her mother a year and a half before. So this was a very tough time. And the guys at Columbia Presbyterian came out and said, listen, the good news is the best guy on the planet just got set up by Sloan Kettering. He's an Olympic swimmer, but he's innovated all these neat ways of pioneering the recovery of eyesight and able to live. And so I took care of all the adoption and stuff. And I went into this guy's office. I said, okay, listen, this is what's going on. Just take out my left eye if it gives me 15, 20 more months, and then we'll deal with the rest of it after that. How's that sound? And this guy looks at me, he goes, okay, let's see what you have first, okay? And everything just sort of went, whoa. And it turns out it was a benign tumor that we can't operate on, but it's got a fluid that is leaking that is blinding me. But as Chuck used to tell me, he goes, I went to complain to Chuck, and here he is in a wheelchair with a colostomy bag. He's just tooling around doing his paintings, and he goes, hey, just be glad you're not doing sculpture, you know? You know, it's like, the guy is the Energizer Bunny, you know, he just kept on going. And so that part was really invigorating, and I hide a cross-section of that as it progresses in a lot of paintings. And then lastly, as we move down here, this is the part that was really funny, is that it cracked me up how stubborn Barbara was. Barbara Novak is one of the great 19th century scholars in American art history. And Sue Simpson was under her wing for a number of years at Columbia. And Barbara took us on a trip where we followed Thomas Moran's trail through Yellowstone. And it was really cool. And the thing that was so neat about these spontaneous trips is that the junket was usurped by this cool geek who was a geologist who just, oh no, I like the paintings, but, and he started telling stories about these different sections we were going through that stole the show, and we were all riveted. Barbara couldn't believe it, but we finally got to the Mammoth Hot Springs, and she stubborn, because how stubborn Barbara was to embrace she refused to embrace artist license. I mean, she was looking at this, she had a drawing that Thomas Moran did of the falls, and we were standing in the exact spot he was, but the real life rock form was off to the side. And she goes, no, he wasn't here. I said, Barbara, he only had this much paper. He just moved that thing in there, and this is what we do. It's artist license, you know. And she goes, no, he would never do that. No. He's in a different place. And it just didn't happen. You know, it was just there. So that's the way this wound up. So that brings us to more current times. And this is the New York High Line. And it's an interesting setup because it's the largest elevated park in the world. And what you're seeing now is basically an abandoned railroad trestle that they were about to tear down when a couple of guys were bopping along and they skipped work one day and they sat in on a meeting that was organized how they were going to take it down. And they said, no, this can be, we can do something with this. So this is great. And anyway, this is a painting I did for Tom Colicchio. Many of you know who's one of the great chefs. And this is the zero, I zeroed in on this right next to the High Line because this is an image we got off the TV from Tom's, the pilot for this show called Top Chef. And he called up and he goes, oh man, you're not gonna believe how ridiculous this is getting. Bravo wants to do a reality show in the kitchen. Have you heard anything so stupid in your life? And I went, wow, that's kind of cool. He goes, no, but this is hysterical. Let's get a shot of that and put it in your painting. I said, yeah, that'll be cool. It'll be a good joke, you know, for whatever. And we put the thing in the painting. Well, 6 months later, it was the highest rated show on cable TV, and it still is today. And now Tom's biggest problem is he doesn't get to cook much because he's traveling around doing these guest appearances. So that was really fun. But what happened in this thing? We were at the installation of this painting at Colicchio and Sons, right in the Chelsea district. And what you want to understand about the Chelsea art district, it was tradition for the better part of a century. It's been where most of the garages or storage facilities in Lower Manhattan are. And it's a lot of them were run by families from northern New Jersey. A lot of them are Italian families. They come over and they've been running these things, passing them on for generation after generation. And you know, guys come over and it's like, sorry, sir, we have to inspect your elevator. And the guy gets in there, and Mr. Scalapini gets in there and he goes, yeah, it's a beautiful elevator here, isn't it? It's a beautiful elevator, right? Yeah, it's the most beautiful elevator I've ever seen. And that's enough. That's all you hear for that. So anyway, with that in mind, this current generation has inherited this real estate that has gone up 100%, 100 times. I mean, what used to be 8 cents a square foot now is $8-$10 a square foot. And the greatest art galleries in the world have outposts there. And so we were at Colicchio and Sons with this, and Robert Hammond, who was one of the founders of the High Line, comes up and he goes, oh, Stephen, I want you to meet, Anthony Scalapini. His family owns two buildings that abut the High Line. I went, whoa, nice to meet you. And he was wearing a white suit that when you got it different angles, it did some interesting things with light, you know, a little dichroic here or there. Hey, it's a great looking suit. And I said, well, you know, Anthony? He goes, Anthony, you gotta be great. You gotta be feeling great. You know, you've got a couple buildings that about this. This is gonna do wonders for the real estate, even though you don't really need that. He goes, yeah, it's good, it's good. But you left my buildings out of your painting. First of all, I don't paint that way. I just, slash stuff around. So anyway, I was explaining to Anthony artist license. what we did to Barbara. She couldn't handle it. Tony's got to be able to come up with this. So, and you know, in my defense, I didn't go into a 45-minute treatise of artist license. This was 45 seconds at the most. I said, you know, an artist license is the kind of thing where sometimes you change things that may not be there, but you do it because you want a better painting or a better piece of music at the end, and that's kind of what we, I'm halfway through this, and he reaches in his pocket, he pulls out a wad of $100 bills like this, and he starts snapping these things while I'm still talking, and I said, so anyway, that's the way it is. He goes, yeah, that's great. So how much for this your art license that lets you put my buildings back in your fucking painting? Thanks for showing up tonight. This is great. The Simpsons, your congratulations. I can't tell you how happy you were. Enjoy the rest of the evening.
Actually, I've got a voice loud enough to carry through the space. Thank you all so much for joining us. Thank you so much, Stephen, for joining us this evening, for your incomparable gift. The acquisition I am most proud of in my tenure, and I'm so thrilled to be able to honor Al and Ann, our dear friends and supporters. You all please take some time. We've got about 15 minutes yet to enjoy the painting. Please walk into the Whitney, see it. Read its stories, be enamored of it for the first time or the 100th. I know for me, there's much to learn, and I'm just so thrilled to have been here this evening to take part in this lovely event. Thank you all. I appreciate you. Thanks.